people called Good Shepherd Episcopal Church gather here tonight, along with visitors and guests from Granbury and around the diocese, to celebrate a new ministry. With God's guidance, you have called a new priest to serve this congregation, and Mother Suzi Robertson has accepted that call. It's a great day for Good Shepherd and for the Diocese of Fort Worth. I would like to express my gratitude to you, the people of Good Shepherd, for your service to God in and through the Episcopal Church. You make a difference in Granbury and beyond, and you have significant ministries through Habitat for Humanity, Meals for Kids, the Hood County Food Bank, Hood County Christmas, I understand, and as well as ministries as far away as Mexico and Tanzania, and that's quite impressive. And I thank you. And now you will welcome your new priest, who has returned home to the family farm in neighboring Erath County. After years of active service, including serving an historic, predominantly African-American congregation in Houston, an Episcopal school in Abilene, and leading a mission to parish status in Washington State, Suzi thought she was going to retire. But as retired clergy tend to discover, the Lord works in mysterious ways. And Mother Suzi brings to this new calling leadership skills, a heart for the underdog, a wonderful knowledge and perspective, and ability to open the scriptures to all. Tonight's celebration takes place on the date that the church remembers and celebrates the life of William Tyndale, a 16th century scholar most known for translating the Bible into English. His effort to make the Bible accessible to the English native tongue was considered revolutionary, to say the least. When challenged by one scholarly clergyman about his efforts, Tyndale replied, "I will cause the boy that drives the plow to know more of the scriptures than you do." Eventually, Tyndale was tried as a heretic and a schismatic, and then strangled and publicly burned. And we think we have it tough. At any rate, on the day we remember one who strived to make the Bible available to all, we welcome our new priest who has spent a lifetime opening the scriptures to children and adults through godly play. Suzi, I hope that's where any comparison to Tyndale ceases. So tonight, we gather to celebrate this new ministry, which is not simply the celebration of the arrival of the new priest, although we do celebrate Mother Susie's arrival, and she is installed officially as the new priest in charge. It's not so much that as it is the celebration of a new ministry together in Granbury and beyond. For we are all members of the body of Christ, the church. All of us are called, as we say. The Greek word for church is ecclesia, which means the people called out. By our baptism, we are a people called out beyond ourselves. Now, having said that, I want to emphasize tonight that baptism is more than a plugging in as part of the body in order to do the work of the church. It is more than getting a job assignment in order to help the body function. Paul writes of the body of the church as a body. He writes of the church as a body, specifically the body of Christ, and each of us is a member of the risen body of Christ. And some are called to be apostles, and some prophets, and some teachers, and so forth. Each member has a calling, a role. All of that is true. In a sense, we do plug in to serve the body, to build up the body. But tonight I want to suggest that the calling is all of those things and more. Your baptism is more than plugging in as part of the body to do the work of the church. Our calling is more than church work, however noble and valuable and needed. We speak of baptism as new birth. It is the beginning of a life of conversion to Christ. And it includes a lifelong journey to discover, I'm going to suggest two things tonight, to discover two things, our truest selves and our deepest longings. For we do have a great thirst for purpose and meaning. We have a deep desire to connect together our faith and our service, our action and our work, a desire to connect our faith and service at the heart level. Now, the writer and spiritual director, Frederick Buechner, and some of you will recognize this quote, he defines our true calling as the place where our deep gladness meets the world's deep need. The place where our deep gladness meets the world's deep need. Simply put, if we are honest, we want the two to match. We want our deep gladness and the world's deep need to match. And that is a question of discernment and vocation. Now, the word vocation comes from the Latin word voice. And so we think of discerning vocation as listening for the voice, listening for the calling. And Parker Palmer, a Quaker, and Quakers do much more listening than speaking, he says that vocation does not mean a goal that I pursue. It means a calling that I hear. And yet vocation does not come from a voice out there, he says. It doesn't come from a voice out there calling me to something I am not. It comes from a voice in here calling me to be the person I was born to be, accepting the treasure of the true self I already possess. That's Parker Palmer. So true vocation, true calling, intersects with true self. The two meet. In other words, we are not called to be something we are not. We are not called to pretend to be something we are not, even for the noblest and loftiest purposes. We are not called to imitate someone we are not, even those of such high purpose as Mother Teresa or Gandhi or Martin Luther King Jr. We are not called to fake it for the sake of the highest cause. Rather, we are called to discover and be who we are, authentic selfhood. Now, life is full of chores and challenges we don't feel called to do, and I'm not talking about that. It won't work to say I'm not called to do the dishes. I'm talking about the intersection between authenticity and vocation, between true self and true calling, not pretending, not faking it, being who we are, and trusting that God wants that, that our true nature is actually called by God for a purpose. Now, Parker Palmer, the previously mentioned Quaker, has written a little book about vocation entitled Let Your Life Speak. Let Your Life Speak. I recommend it to anyone who is working through a period of discernment. And he tells a story about the intersection between true self and a calling to serve God's purpose. He tells a story which takes place on December the 1st, 1955, in Montgomery, Alabama. An African-American woman, a seamstress in her early 40s, Rosa Parks, you know the story. She sat down at the front of a bus in one of the seats reserved for white people. A dangerous, daring, provocative act in a racist society. Years later, someone would ask Rosa Parks why she sat down at the front of the bus that day. And her answer is a little surprising, not at all spectacular. She did not say that she sat down to launch a movement. Her motives were more basic, more elemental than that. She said, "I sat down because I was tired." Palmer suggests she did not mean that her feet were tired. She meant that her soul was tired. Her heart was tired. Her whole being was tired of playing by racist rules, of denying her soul's claim to selfhood. He says the moment she sat down at the front of the bus on that December day, it was a moment of existential truth, of claiming authentic selfhood, of reclaiming her birthright, reclaiming God's gift. And in that moment, she set in motion a process that changed both the lay of the land and the law of the land. Rosa Parks sat down, he said, because she had reached a point where it was essential to embrace her true vocation. Not as someone who would reshape our society, but as someone who would live out her full self in the world. She decided, I will no longer act on the outside in a way that contradicts the truth on the inside. I will no longer act as if I were less than the whole person I know myself inwardly to be. And perhaps what follows is Palmer's chief point. He says we can look at all the great liberation moments of our times in South Africa, Eastern Europe, among women and African Americans, and what we see is simple but often ignored. The movements that transform us and our world emerge from the lives of people who make the choice for authenticity. In the face of political systems, forcing them to live in a way untrue to who they are and risking punishment, they decide to live divided no more. They decide no longer to act on the outside in a way that contradicts some truth they hold deeply on the inside. They decide to claim authentic selfhood and act it out. And their decisions ripple out to change the society in which they live, serving millions of others. Palmer calls this the Rosa Parks decision. In 1955, Montgomery, Alabama, who possibly could have dreamed it? One defining moment on a bus ripples out to liberate a land. One defining moment on a bus liberates a land. One defining moment on the cross ripples out to liberate the world. Defining moments and ripples. Isn't that really what happens at baptism? We enter the waters of baptism and create a ripple. True for each of us as individual members of the body. True for the body of Christ. True for us, the people of Good Shepherd Granbury. We are called to our true vocation as a body, to embody the attributes of Jesus, to embody the love of Jesus, a love offered without conditions, to embody the grace of Jesus, unearned, unmerited grace, to embody the forgiveness of Jesus, who forgives us from the cross. But I mean, there are no apologies, there's no general confession first. To embody the compassion of Jesus who touches the leper. To embody the mercy of Jesus for when we fail. We step into the waters of baptism and true vocation is claimed. Who you are born to be is accepted and claimed. And we participate in what happens next. A ripple effect as all are liberated by the good news in the name of the Holy Trinity, one God, in whom we live and move and have our being.